thank you for your annual membership through the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Additional programming funds provided by Black Hills State University, a comprehensive public university offering degrees in business, education, science, and the liberal arts. BHSU.edu.
The Black Hills of South Dakota has been struggling with a mountain pine beetle epidemic for several years. It's gotten so bad, our congressional leaders are in the process of introducing a bill that would allow the U.S. Forest Service to move faster on programs to fight the infestation. Tonight, we'll bring you up to date on the latest efforts and what you need to know about protecting your land. That's the mountain pine beetle on tonight's South Dakota Focus. Up next.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Hello and welcome to South Dakota Focus. I'm Stephanie Rissler. Last fall, we looked at the serious situation in the Black Hills caused by the mountain pine beetle. Tonight, we re-examine the problem, but more importantly, we'll talk about the planning underway to fight the mountain pine beetle infestation. We'll fill you in on what you need to know as both the state and federal government consider ways to save the Black Hills. Joining me tonight to talk about the issue, Ray Sowers, the director and state forester with the South Dakota Department of Agriculture. Next, Dr. John Ball, professor of forestry with South Dakota State University. Dr. Ball is also in charge of forest health for the South Dakota Department of Agriculture. And from the United States Forest Service, representing the Rocky Mountain region, we have Kurt Allen. And last, Jeff Parrott, representing the Black Hills Forest Resource Association. Jeff is also the vice president of Wheeler Lumber, located in Whitewood, South Dakota. And on top of those titles, Jeff is the current president of the Intermountain Forest Association. Thanks and welcome to all of you for coming in tonight. Just a reminder to our viewers, we are live. So if you have a question or a comment for one of our guests regarding tonight's topic, give us a call. It's toll free. The number is 1-877-825-5788, and our email address is sdfocus@sdpb.org. We've got lots to talk about, so we're going to go ahead and we're going to get started. Ray, we'll start with you. I know you helped us out when we visited this issue last time. When you were last here, we talked that the infested ponderosa pine trees, it was about 400,000 acres of the 1.2 million acre Black Hills National Forest. It was a lot that had been attacked by the mountain pine beetle. Where are we today in terms of acres, of numbers? Do we know?
I believe those figures are probably still accurate. They're the latest we have. When we did the program last time, those figures haven't changed since then.
Okay.
So they will be changing again, of course, this summer as the beetles leave the trees and move to others.
Okay, okay. Dr. Ball, the last time we were here, you joined us from Rapid City because you were out there researching this very topic. What can you tell us in terms of numbers? Did you see, with your research, did you find things had gotten worse? Were they holding steady?
Well, you know what, it depends on where you're in the hills, because there's some areas we've already had the epidemic come up and it's already winding down. We have other areas where it's still increasing. We have other areas where it's plateauing. So it's one of the things where you live in the hills locally, it might be quite different than someone maybe 30 or 40 miles away. But there is one common point, and that is the beetles are exactly where they should be at this time, and that is they're in the larval stage and they're not going to be emerging soon. And the reason I say that is over the last couple of weeks, there's a tremendous concern among people. They're thinking, oh my goodness, there's two generations that the beetles will be flying out soon, and then there'll be another generation in August. And Kurt Allen and I have gone out there and sampled, and the beetles, even though it's been a warmer spring than we normally have, the beetles have not developed that much faster. We still don't expect the emergence to be much earlier than the typical July. So from the standpoint of the beetles, they're right about where we expect them to be, and they'll be flying about the end of July as normal.
Okay, you answered one of the questions coming up, so that's good to know. Kurt, with the National Forest Service, I imagine you're in the hot seat quite often.
Occasionally, yes.
And you live out in the Black Hills.
Sure.
I'm guessing what we've heard so far is pretty much accurate. We haven't really seen a huge increase. We're kind of where we need to be, and you're working on
You know, and that's, you know, what's been said is about right. You know, one of the things that I think is still kind of amazing to me is we're a long ways into this epidemic now. We're a good 10, 12 years into this, and we're still seeing new acres get infested, and we're still seeing the beetles really, I won't even say staying steady, they're still increasing and expanding. And where we are at this point in time in this epidemic, you know, you would think, hopefully, that we'd be starting to see that plateau or even in downturn, but it's just not there right now.
Mm-hmm. How would you describe the health of the forest?
Well, the first word that comes to mind is changing, and changing rather rapidly out there. You know, we are in a lot of areas going from a more mature forest and to a forest of baby trees. Mm-hmm. You know, as the mature forest gets largely killed off in some places. You know, that is the one good thing we have going for us in some of the places where we have had already some serious die-off. There are a lot of baby trees coming up underneath it, but it's a very different forest than where we were 10, 15 years ago.
All right, just a reminder to our viewers, we are going to kind of bring you up to date on the situation with the mountain pine beetle, but we're really going to talk about what is going to be done here to bring those numbers down. So if you have questions, whether it be on spraying or thinning the forest or some of the other methods that have been or could be used, call in tonight, visit with our experts, let them know what's on your mind, and we'll try to get those questions answered. Jeff, I want to go to you. You know, I know representing kind of the timber industry tonight on one hand, but also you work in the timber industry. So first, talk to us about how this epidemic has impacted, you know, your job, what you do for a living out there.
Well, our industry is pretty varied in the Black Hills. Fortunately, we still have a strong industry here, unlike some other areas in the country that have been devastated by mountain pine beetles. We still do have a very active industry here. The pine beetle problem has stretched our resources thin. Mm-hmm. You know, the sales that are being cut today were marked 5, 6, 7 years ago, and beetles are moving constantly. So we're trying to be active and take everything we can that's been hit by the pine beetle and the green tree when we're allowed to. There's a lot of that going on now in the sales today. We are limited, you know, by law in the timber sales with the Forest Service, and they're working with us quite well to get out what we can, because we know every tree we take is 4 trees that aren't hit next year. So, but we are stretched thin. We really need a comprehensive plan to attack this problem. And I know there's some people working on that. So.
I want to ask you the same question that I asked Kurt, and that is, you know, the health of the forest. You really depend on the forest for your livelihood. How would you define the health of our forest?
I think, as Kurt said, it's changing constantly. And the beetles have affected that. It's pretty obvious to most people. They drive up into the Black Hills and they look at Harney Peak and Black Elk Wilderness and the total devastation there. And the central part of the hills has been attacked very hard, and the beetles are moving. You know, we look at it as for our livelihood. You know, we try to advocate for sustainable forestry, and it's the future of our employees. To have timber out there to be able to harvest and supply to the people that need it. So we need a healthy forest too, and the more acres that are killed by mountain pine beetle is forests in the future that aren't going to be there. It's going to take a long time for them to recover.
All right. As we talk tonight, our viewers, you'll see some different images popping up made possible through Dr. John Ball's folks and from the National Forest Service and the Department of Ag. If you want to look at those more in depth, all of those are on our website. And some of those are alarming to see what's going on out there. Dr. Ball, I'm going to come back to you. You know, I think most of the folks understand what's going on with the mountain pine beetle, but they might not know how the pine beetle operates and how it destroys. You did a great job last time of kind of explaining the whole process of how that beetle operates and what happens. I want you to kind of bring everybody up to date on the bug again.
Sure. A beetle in a minute.
Yeah.
What it is the mountain pine beetle leaves a dead tree, usually sometime in July or early August. The peak of the flight is time just before rally, so bikers and beetles go together.
Uh-huh.
And once the beetle leaves the tree, it finds another tree, usually within about 300 feet of where it left. And when it finds that tree, and finds a really nice tree, it'll release a pheromone, an odor, if you will, to draw in other beetles, kind of a flash mob for bugs. And the success of this beetle depends on the mass attacking the tree. In other words, a beetle or two on itself is not going to kill a tree. But by the hundreds, they literally can overcome the tree's defenses, which is that sap you see being produced, and they're able to get underneath under the bark and start their families. When they enter the tree, they also bring with them a fungus. They kind of pack their lunch, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And that fungus is also now in their tunnels, and they feed on this fungus as part of their process of eating the tree. And the fungus also starts plugging up some of the vessels, some of the tubes in the trees that moves water and the food. And as the beetle's going through the tree, it's also plugging those up.
Okay.
Well, the beetle spends the entire winter in a larval stage, forms a little cocoon, pupae in the spring, and then once summer comes, flies out of the tree that's now dead host, and now attacks a new living host.
Okay. All right. Can a tree be saved if you find a couple beetles on your tree? Can you get rid of them and save your tree?
Well, we have what we refer to as attacks that weren't successful. In other words, the beetles attack the tree, but not in large enough numbers. They're pitch outs, we call them. It's usually a large glob of pitch. And when that happens, the tree was able to fight off the beetles and not enough attacked it to overcome its defenses. But once they're inside the tree and successfully work their way into the tree, there's nothing you can do to save that tree. And that's really hard on folks, because one of the questions Kurt and I get, someone's got a tree, it's been hit, you can tell the beetles are inside it, the pitch masses are small, and they're saying, well, what can I spray, what can I inject, what can I do to save my tree? There's nothing. Once it's in the tree, you're out of luck.
For folks tuning in tonight, if you think you're watching Garden Line, you are not. Dr. John Ball, of course, a familiar face on Garden Line.
Good point.
Yes, exactly. Kurt, I'm going to come to you with this next question. People, you know, may want to know, what has contributed to this outbreak that you said that we're going on 12 years now?
Yeah, at least 12 years that we're on now. And, you know, the single biggest factor we have with mountain pine beetle in the Black Hills is just the condition of the forest. And, you know, the mountain pine beetle really needs and thrives and expands in dense forest stands. And, you know, 10, 15 years ago when this thing started, we had a significant amount of the Black Hills was in a very susceptible state to mountain pine beetle. It was, you know, really, it was kind of like we'd set out the $2 all-you-can-eat buffet at that point in time. And they came and they started eating, and they haven't stopped. And so that's really the big thing that drives it that we've seen, is that stand density and the stand conditions. I mean, over the times that John and I have looked at, there's really no weather factor, if you will. I mean, a lot of people like to say, you know, oh, cold, you know, our winters aren't cold enough, or drought, and you know, there are some minor contributing pieces there perhaps, but really not what's driving the beetle and what's really driving this epidemic.
So folks may want to know, we're going to talk about some of the man-made efforts to bring the numbers down in a few minutes, but what are the natural ways that Mother Nature would get rid of such a thing?
Well, obviously the first one that comes to mind is fire. You know, a fire will thin out the forest and thin out the trees a little bit.
I think you're asking what takes care of the beetle, right?
The beetle.
Oh, what kills the beetles?
Absolutely,
yeah. Woodpeckers.
Well, a fire would kill a beetle too, I'm guessing.
Takes care of the tree too, but you know.
You know, we've had that discussion about that, and really for a fire to kill the beetles under the trees there, I mean, you'd be killing a lot of other stuff too, a lot of collateral damage. Really, you know, the mountain pine beetle is a native to the Black Hills. It's mm-hmm. been here as long as there's been pine trees, basically, in the forest. And so it has a whole suite of natural enemies, if you will. There's other insects that eat it. There's woodpeckers, as John pointed out, you know, mm-hmm. are eat it. But, you know, what we've seen time and time again, when it gets to these epidemic proportions, they just don't keep up. I mean, they're good at keeping them in check when there's not so many beetles around. But once it gets to the place where we are now, where we've just got literally billions of beetles, if you will, out there, the natural controls just don't keep up. We can't grow enough woodpeckers to eat the beetles.
Yeah. So, Ray, when was it that, you know, folks with the state or even at the federal level realized that we needed to step in and do something?
We got specifically involved in Custer State Park. I believe it was the year 2004 when we first noticed that the beetles were starting to increase in numbers within the park, and especially in the Black Elk Wilderness area just outside the park. So in 2005, we started suppression actions at that time.
Okay.
So we've been doing suppression actions in Custer State Park since 2005.
Okay. So Jeff, I'm going to throw it down to you. One of the things we'll talk about tonight is thinning the forest. I'm guessing that that's where the timber industry comes in. Just curious your thoughts. I mean, you know, I'm sure that the timber industry has had some criticism because of the thinning, or at least I've read some. Where is the stance from the Resource Association stand?
Well, as Kurt mentioned earlier, mountain pine beetles attack dense stands of wood.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's their buffet. And science has shown, and on the ground has shown, that thinning the forest helps in keeping down the populations of mountain pine beetles. And so, you know, from our standpoint, we view that, you know, our industry is a tool for the Forest Service to utilize to go in, thin the forest, keep the beetles in check. You know, it produces a product we can utilize. And, you know, the problem now is this problem is so big that it's almost gotten beyond the scope of you know, with the industry we have and the dollars available to the state, federal agencies, you know, to go out and stop the problem. We need, you know, a collaborative effort from everyone across all industries to really attack this problem.
Now, can the timber industry use any of the wood that's been attacked by the beetles?
Yes. The green hit trees, you know, if we can get in early before the beetles spread through that wood with creating the blue stain and bringing the blue stain in. It's very usable for our industry here. The blue stain does create a problem for us in that most of the product produced here in the Black Hills are boards, which are used primarily in the housing industry for siding and clabbers on houses, things of that nature that, you know, people want a nice white piece of wood. So the market for blue stain wood here is pretty small. But we've taken the approach that, you know, unless we go out and take every tree that we're allowed to take on the timber sale and try to cut down the number of beetles that are out there, you know, we're not gonna have any wood left.
Yeah.
It has been shown that the blue stain doesn't affect the strength of the wood. In other areas of the country, particularly, you know, in areas where they have lodgepole pine, standing dead timber typically will last longer and still get a decent product out of it than you can with ponderosa pine. So the key for our industry is get in there as quick as we can before the beetles fly, and timing is everything.
Okay, and they're getting ready to fly in July, right?
Right, in July.
All right, Ray, I saw you maybe interested in hitting on the thinning issue.
Yeah, I just wanted to reiterate what he had said, that thinning is a good preventative measure, but once you're in an epidemic, like we are now, thinning alone is not going to prevent the epidemic from spreading. It may slow down that spread in certain areas, but it won't prevent the epidemic from continuing and even growing. And we've seen that. I think the experts would verify that thinning is a good preventative measure and will keep the beetles from growing to epidemic levels, but once they're at epidemic levels, the thinning by itself will not suffice.
Okay, we're going to continue to talk about ways to fight the epidemic. We do have a couple emails that came in. Ray, we're going to stay with you for the first one. What is the annual state budget to fight the pine beetle? And that is from John in Pierre.
Our annual state budget, year in and year out, is not very large. Last year we had about $600,000. We were discussing this just before the show started. The governor and the legislature has supported the governor's initiative, which provides $4,000 over the next 3 years to fight the beetles on private lands. And we got an extra $2.1 million to work on the beetle problems within Custer State Park directly.
And that was this past legislative session,
yes,
right?
Yes, it was.
All right, next email question. Well, could your panel, we'll see if we can get it up here, could your panel address the economic impacts to the area in the next 5 to 10 years, especially in regards to tourism and the logging industry and real estate? So let's do this. Let's start with Jeff down there. You can touch on the issue regarding logging.
Well, from the timber industry standpoint, you know, there's still a lot of good timber out there. I mean, all is not lost. I mean, we've got a big problem, you know, that's been concentrated in the central part of the Black Hills, and it's spreading, continues to spread. You know, we're still getting good quality wood out of the woods on the sales that we have. We're trying to take everything that's green hit out of the woods with it, so we can at least slow down the beetle in areas that we're in. 5 to 10 years down the road, it's hard to say. From an industry standpoint, we're hoping that we can somehow, some way, you know, slow the beetle down. Whether it will be successful or not, that remains to be seen. At least in our area, we're lucky that we have a lot of people that are willing to collaborate across agencies to help one another to try to solve a problem. And in other parts of the country, for example, in Colorado, that didn't happen. And we still have a fighting chance here, and all is not lost yet. But we have to be very diligent in how we approach the problem on a collaborative standpoint. And as always, funding is always an issue also.
So Kurt, I would imagine that the Forest Service kind of keeps track of visitors that come to our forest and
sure.
vacation and
sure.
enjoy it.
Sure.
Any idea, has the discussion happened on how this could impact visitors?
You know, I know that discussion is taking place on the impacts on the tourism industry. You know, I don't really know the answer to that question. I know that is a great deal of concern because, you know, part of what really draws a large number of folks to the Black Hills every year as tourists is, you know, they want to see the forest. You know, I mean, really, that's what they come here for. You know, and like I said, it's changing rapidly, and how that's going to play out over the long haul with the tourists and the folks who are coming here, I don't really know. But I know it is being looked at, and it's something that's a high level of concern.
Do we know, and I don't know, Ray, if you know the answer to this, have we seen a slowdown in visitors because of it?
I believe the tourist industry has indicated that they may be seeing some reduced numbers, but I haven't seen any good statistics on that. I don't know if anybody else has. I would say that's probably going to be the industry that is hurt the most here in the next few years with all the red tops that are visible.
Yeah.
As long as we have visible red trees all over the hills, tourists are going to be concerned.
Right. Well,
and that will impact.
The other thing, too, is when I'm out working in the woods, Custer up to Harney Peak and that, And you talk to the tourists that are walking up there, and they're just walking through mile after mile of standing dead trees, and it's just not quite the same, obviously. Mm-hmm. And so I'm sure we're going to see an impact. I mean, imagine going to a campground where the trees are either all dead or all gone. Mm-hmm. You know, it's, but that'll be a few years to come. As you mentioned, we still have quite a forest. It's not the case where we need to quit now, we can't do anything. We've got a lot to save still.
Let's keep talking about ways where we can cut down on the numbers. John, I'm going to stay with you. Let's talk about the spraying. I know that a lot of folks have visited with you. They've had a lot of questions about it. How big, or will spraying be a big way that people look to when they want to get rid of those bugs? Will that be what they want to use versus the thinning or controlled burns? Will that be the number one thing?
Well, it can be, but then we're looking at a different management. You know, spraying, and this is an important thing, no one is advocating, no one is looking at spraying the entire forest. First of all, we don't have any chemicals that would be legal to do that, and since this beetle attacks the lower part of the tree, you can't kill it by spraying pesticides aerially anyway. What we're focusing the spraying on is if you are in an area where you have an active outbreak, that you're seeing dead trees near you, that those key trees by your cabin, by your home, those three or four or five large pines that are so important to your property, those are the trees that you might want to consider spraying, because if you spray those trees with the right chemical at the right time, you have at least a 97 to 99% chance of not having them be successfully attacked. And it's very cost effective in the hills. There's a lot of companies out there doing it. And if you compared what it would cost to remove one of those large trees, spraying is certainly cost effective. But the point is, choose those large trees, those important trees to your landscape around your home or your cabin, and look at spraying those. We're not looking at spraying as a means of reducing the bug population forest-wide. It can't be done. Mm-hmm. But it's a very effective technique for protecting those valuable trees in your yard. So it's quite different from thinning. Thinning, we're trying to manage at a larger scale. Here we're saying, you know what, you're going to lose a few trees, but we're going to make sure these trees are not the ones lost. So spraying's important.
Now, when I think of just spraying for bugs in general, it's a yearly thing. Is that the same with trees?
Yes. When you know, and we tell people that I think Kurt and I've said, you know, if you're going to go into it, figure you're going to go into it for 5 years at least. In other words, if someone stops by and says, we can spray your three trees here and it'll cost you $80, figure you're going to spend $80 every year for the next 5 years, because this is not a vaccination. You're spraying the trunk of the tree to kill the beetles as they land on it. And you're only going to protect that tree, not the trees around it. So, you know, don't figure, well, I'll spray these three trees and that'll kill all the beetles attacking all the rest of my trees. It will not. But it will protect those trees. But the spray, and this is very important, I'm glad you brought it up, because Kurt and I are telling people, now is when you want to spray. The chemicals that are effective, if you put them on during the month of May, will certainly be there to kill the beetles when they start flying in July. So this is one of those things, unlike my taxes where I waited till Monday, you know, you don't want to wait. You want to get it done in May.
You and me both.
Thank goodness they gave us that extra day.
You know? Yes. Okay, so they got to do it now. Can they do it themselves? If they can do it themselves, where do they get the chemicals?
Well, South Dakota's the land of do-it-yourselfers. And yes, there are products you can buy, but here's the problem. You've got to spray up that whole tree, at least all the way up to the trunk's 5 inches. So you might be spraying 30, 40, 50 feet, and you have to spray it with enough force that the pesticide actually penetrates all the bark crevices. And that means you need a power sprayer, 250 to 400 PSI, and that's out the nozzle. Now, we get people calling and say, well, you know, I got my power washer. Can I use that? No. Or can I climb a ladder with a hose end sprayer? No. And the other problem we have, and this is an important one, if everyone hired someone to spray, spray contractors are under a lot of regulations, you know, in terms of how they spray, how much mm-hmm. they can legally spray, how they dispose of products. You know, with homeowners, landowners quite often, well, I've used up half the bottle. What will I do with the other half? And I think we'd all be better off if people said, you know what, I'll pay. And I talked to one of the companies that sells sprays and also does spraying, and they said they've had a number of folks come in and said, well, I bought my sprayer, I bought all this chemical, and I'm going out and spraying. And then they realize, it'd been a lot better if I just had hired you and gone fishing. Mm-hmm. So we certainly suggest that people consider hiring someone.
Is the National Forest Service, are you guys going to use spraying as a means?
On the National Forest, we are spraying some trees in some selected campgrounds. Like John pointed out, it's not something we can do on a landscape scale. It is something we are selecting, you know, a few of the large trees in some of the popular campgrounds that, you know, it would be a real shame if we lost that. I mean, we have a large investment in the, you know, the campgrounds already with the maintenance and the toilets and everything. And, you know, generally, you know, when folks go camping out there, they like to have trees to camp under, you know, more than likely. And so, you know, yes, we're doing a little bit of selective spraying.
Now, what about the Department of Ag?
We are doing some spraying within Custer State Park in the same areas, sure. Campgrounds and around some of the important facilities. It's not a widespread spraying, it's select trees.
Okay. I have an email that came through. We're going to continue to talk about spraying because there's a lot of questions I still have, but I want to get to this email. Could compaction of soil and roots stress trees and make them more susceptible to mountain pine borer? What effect does heavy equipment compaction have on forest soil and the growth of new trees? And last, so what has happened to throw off the balance between pine beetle and natural predators and allow the enormous surge of mountain pine beetles?
Boy, I'll start that one, you can jump in. You know, the compaction issue is kind of an interesting one, and one thing that people would be surprised to find is that the mechanized equipment that's being utilized is actually designed to minimize compaction. If you really wanted to compact these soils, let's go back to horses, and we would have it. And that's been studied quite often. So the equipment that's being used is being used in a way to minimize compaction. Now, the other part, though, to this is mountain pine beetle is an interesting beetle in that it doesn't react to stress. It doesn't attack trees because they're stressed. It doesn't attack trees because they were struck by lightning or that the roots have been disturbed or if you did construction around them. This beetle attacks trees when there's a lot of trees. And so it's a little different, and Kurt can kind of finish up on that.
Yeah, you know, because there are a lot of the bark beetles in the West, and even some in the hills, some of the smaller, the Ips beetles, smaller cousin, if you will, of mountain pine beetle, that really do strive on stress trees, on storm damaged trees, drought stress trees, you know, soil trees around houses that have gotten damaged. But mountain pine beetle, we have never, we just never have seen any connection between it and, you know, any sort of stress tree.
In fact, they
actually prefer, I find, you know, I think they actually prefer, you know, they really need a healthy host, so to speak, you know, a good vigorous tree because, you know, their larvae are growing in that, living in that growing part of the tree, and the better that is, the better their offspring do.
And it has been studied looking at logging damage if you hit a tree or that, and there's no relationship to beetle attack at all. No.
We're going to go to a video in just a few minutes, and we're going to continue to talk about the spraying, but Jeff, there's an email that came through that maybe you could answer. Steve from Sioux Falls would like to know, is there an alternative use of the wood that has been infested?
There's been a lot of study, conferences, a lot of, once again, collaboration on the use of blue stain wood. And I know they have a program in Colorado going out marketing blue stain wood, which is primarily lodgepole pine, which is primarily used for dimensional lumber, such as framing lumber. And once, as I said earlier, the blue stain doesn't affect the structural integrity of the wood. So in that regard, you know, for framing lumber, it can be used. Now, ponderosa pine is not a very well-suited wood to make framing lumber out of. It's primarily used for boards. And so there's a market out there for some of that type of blue stain ponderosa pine. It's very small. I mean, a lot of people have been looking at it for many years, trying to develop markets for it, and that's an ongoing process.
All right, very good. Thanks for that email that came in. Now, there are groups in the Black Hills and across the nation that have great concerns over the environmental impact that could occur with some of the plans to control the mountain pine beetle infestation. Earlier this week, I visited with an individual who does have some major concerns over things like thinning the forest, controlled burns, and spraying to help bring down those mountain pine beetle numbers.
His name is Dwayne Short, and he is the Wild Species Program Director with an organization in Laramie, Wyoming called Biodiversity Conservation Alliance. Here's part of our interview. Now joining me, I have Dwayne Short. He's the Wild Species Program Director with Biodiversity Conservation Alliance. It's out of Laramie, Wyoming. Dwayne, thanks for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
A lot of folks may be unfamiliar with what the Biodiversity Conservation Alliance is. If you can, talk to us about the mission of the organization.
Okay, our mission is quite simple. We are dedicated to protecting wildlife and wild places throughout Wyoming and surrounding states, primarily on public lands.
From your perspective, as we look at the issue of the whole outbreak in general, I know that there's different theories and whatnot. Do you see that the outbreak of the mountain pine beetle, at least in the Black Hills, is that a natural cycle that happens every, 100 years or so? Where do you guys see the outbreak?
Well, the outbreak certainly is natural. The pine beetle, the mountain pine beetle, is native to the Black Hills, as it is to most of the Rocky Mountain region. And yes, it occurs every few years. A major outbreak every 100 to 300 years is the common wisdom. And this one is certainly one of the more pronounced outbreaks that we've seen in recorded history.
As our viewers are watching, hundreds in the Black Hills, they may be those landowners that are in, parts of the forest. They've lost hundreds of trees. They're worried about possible fires on their own land, destroying their structure. From a scientist's perspective, they may wonder, is there any good beneficial reason for an outbreak? Could there be a silver lining in what we're seeing?
Oh, there certainly is. The beetles, when they're present in such numbers, are thinning the forest. And this is something the Forest Service is always proposing to do. We want to thin the forest. It makes for a better forest. Well, the beetles are doing this, and they're not charging us, really. Of course, they do kill trees that may have some market value. But in the grander scheme of things, they actually thin the forest. These trees eventually fall. The trees then go into the nutrient recycling business and replenish and essentially fertilize the forest landscape again. And once and I've covered this to some extent, but once the deadfall is on the ground, then the beetles actually help to break the fiber down and turn it back into nutrients for the soil.
As I mentioned, there's plans underway to start controlling the mountain pine beetle. From the BCA's perspective, what are your biggest concerns as some of our government agents move forward with some of these plans of attack?
Well, the greatest concerns are that a great deal of effort, money, human resources will go into these projects, that science is repeatedly showing don't work. We're also concerned for all of the disturbance to the forest that will follow this outbreak. And as I mentioned before, the wildlife will respond to natural occurrences. But to go in and mechanically thin hundreds of thousands of acres of forest that have already been thinned rather drastically by the mountain pine beetle, it does not make a lot of sense, and it even in a sense defies common sense.
Well, what would be the solution from the perspective of the Biodiversity Conservation Alliance? Is it just to let nature take its course? Is it to maybe do some control efforts, but not as much as people are implying that we should do? I guess, what would be your solution?
Yes, we do believe there are solutions to some of the problems created by this pine beetle outbreak. And those are, as I just mentioned, treating these wildland-urban interface areas or zones that are near private property and homes and that sort of thing. Treating around campgrounds, roadways, the utility lines certainly have to be protected, and that there can be miles and miles and miles of road and utility lines and trails. So we say do that, that's fine. But to go out and really do much in the backcountry, and I hesitate to say let nature take its course, because that seems to have a negative connotation these days. It's something that, as a biologist, I have a hard time understanding. But basically do what is effective and efficient and even, cost-effective. But let's stay out of the backcountry, and there will be special circumstances for sure in the backcountry that may require some kind of response to this beetle outbreak. But there is something we can do, how we can take advantage of this beetle outbreak, and that is to study it. It's fine and it's noble to want to do something, but studying and doing research is also doing something. And we cannot research how the forest responds to these types of natural calamities, if we want to call them that, unless we allow the forest to respond the way it responds. If we go in and intervene, we will never know how the forest should respond, and we are getting further and further and further from those scientific truths, because we just don't have that much forest left in this nation or in the world that's undisturbed, so that we can even observe natural processes over the long term. And that's one of the problems. As human beings, we want to look at the here and now and make assumptions about longer term matters. So.
Okay. All right. Dwayne Short, the Wild Species Program Director with Biodiversity Conservation Alliance. Thank you, sir, for taking the time out of Laramie, Wyoming, to join us and visit with us today.
Well, thank you.
All right, and that was an interview that I was able to do with Dwayne yesterday. We did edit part of that. If you would like to see the full unedited version, we did spend about 40 minutes visiting about the issue. It is on our website at sdpb.org. Dr. Ball, I'll come to you. I know we sat here and listened, and that's definitely a different perspective mm-hmm. from Dwayne. Your thoughts on what he had to say.
Well, three things. First of all, when he says that these outbreaks occur every 100 to 300 years, he's absolutely incorrect. They occur in a much more frequent time scale, and we're talking about the major ones. We did have one in the 1890s, we had one in the 1930s, we had one in the 1970s. We're having them now, and they've seen that throughout the West. So his time period is incorrect. The next thing, and I see this often said, well, the beetles will thin the trees. The beetles don't thin trees, beetles do clear cuts. Best example of this is get up and take a look at the Black Elk Wilderness. It's not just this thinning where we now say we have fewer live trees. We have no live trees on that hillside. Now, that is natural, and people are entitled to their opinion of that as to whether or not we should allow nature to take its course, and understand from a biologist why someone would present that, and I can see a viewpoint. But it's not thinning. The beetles, when they attack in these large outbreaks, just essentially kill everything. And his third comment, that it needs to be studied, well, it is being studied. I have PhD students right now that are working in the Black Elk Wilderness area, which is an undisturbed area, that are looking at changes in wildlife, mostly avian and small mammals. But we are using this opportunity to study the impact of mountain pine beetle on a variety of wildlife and other things, because again, we have these opportunities about every 40 years. And I would 100% agree with them that we do need to take this opportunity to study, because this is more information that can be used on the next outbreak, which will occur 40 years hence, not 100 years hence.
All right, more questions are coming in. This next one, we're going to throw it to Jeff. If thinning the forest would have kept the forest healthy enough to fight off the beetle, why wasn't more thinning done? Diana.
That's a very good question. We get that a lot from our industry, too. There's not an easy answer to that. In the Black Hills National Forest, obviously the Forest Service manages those lands. We've got about 1 million acres of forest there. In order to go in and thin the forest, Forest Service has to go through the NEPA process, which is an environmental impact statement over an area of land, to go in and analyze different options of how they're going to actually manage that land, what they're going to do to thin, whether it's going to be cuts for wildlife or tree generation and aspen regeneration, all sorts of things. That takes years to get that done, and then and money. And so there's only an opportunity to do so much over a period of time, and it takes time to get that done. And we've got to do it responsibly, and obviously we'd like the things to move a little faster than they do at this point in time. And some of the legislation that's being addressing that now to try to move a little quicker, to possibly, you know, declare an emergency situation where we can go in and move faster. I think we've seen the state of South Dakota has a little bit different way they do things. They obviously, you look at Custer State Park, they've been able to go in and actively manage that piece of property probably a lot better than we've done in the Black Hills and the Forest Service side, just because they don't have the regulatory issues, the national regulatory issues to deal with, where they can manage their lands a little quicker.
Well, and you mentioned briefly there, we did see that Senator Thune and Representative Noem, they're talking about filing a bill that would allow the U.S. Forest Service to move faster when planning and carrying out programs. You were at that press conference, so I know you can kind of just give us what you heard that day.
Yes. Senator Thune and Representative Noem each have sent a bill or drafted a bill in their representative congresses that is something that they'd like to attach to the Farm Bill, which would expand upon the Healthy Forest Act, which was some legislation that was done a few years ago to try to expedite timber sales in the wildlife-urban interface, which is a zone of federal land backing up to private land. And there was some pretty language in that act that was a little bit ambiguous. It was hard to really clarify what was meant by it. So this new legislation is trying to clear that up. They want to expand upon the categorical exclusion that the Forest Service has as a tool to go in and do small acreages of land and act quickly, where they don't have to go through all the NEPA process is a little quicker to do that. So this legislation will allow more acres to be treated that way, basically to declare an emergency in certain areas of the forest where they have this huge problem. Hopefully that process will get through this year sometime, and just another tool to help the Forest Service move a little quicker.
I'm going to read an email that maybe hits on one of the issue when it comes to moving faster, maybe not. It comes from Frank. Frank says the BCA, which is the biodiversity organization that Duane was with, is arguing that we should study cancer and leave it to do what it will. We cannot appropriately thin because of BCA lawsuits. And that was an email that came in. Duane is not here to represent himself. I don't know if anybody on the panel wants to touch on that.
I could probably speak to that a little bit. The formal NEPA process that I spoke of earlier, you go through this environmental analysis and different options are picked to go in and manage a piece of land. Once that timber sale contract goes out, then the public has an opportunity to appeal that decision. And that appeal then goes through a court system. With the Healthy Forest Act, one of the things that changed in with that act is the Forest Service can designate a sale through that system, where the appeal process is changed to an objection process. That process then, if someone objects to it, they can go in and have a discussion with the Forest Service, raise their objections to that sale. The Forest Service then can come back and say, well, I know what you mean. We might change this or we might change that, but they ultimately will make that decision right then and there and move forward. So that's one of the things that we're trying to do to speed up the process a little bit, that we're trusting the Forest Service. They're good managers of the land, and let them do their job.
Okay, we have a number of emails that we still need to get to, and this is hard to believe, but we've only got 6 minutes left in the show. Dr. Ball, this next one, it was an email that came through, somebody wanting you to touch on the issue of pheromones.
Well, again, the beetles do use a communication system to draw in other beetles, and they also use a communication system to tell other beetles to go away. The pheromone to make them go away is called verbenone, and you can actually buy that as a way of putting it on your tree to repel the beetles from attacking.
So it's a spray?
Not a spray. It's a little pouch you put on. You staple it on it, releases this odor.
Okay.
A little sachet, if you will. Releases this odor, and you can't smell it, nor your dog, but it'll repel the beetles, or it should, but it does not work in the Black Hills.
Okay.
Our beetles are a little different. And the other pheromone that actually draws the beetles in, they've made that too as a little pouch you can put on a tree. But that works too well, and you can actually end up bringing in a tremendous number of beetles, so we don't recommend that.
Yeah, you know, and like John pointed out, the one, the verbenone, the anti-aggregation pheromone is called, it's typically...
beetle block.
Beetle block is how it's referred to in the public there. You know, and we just haven't, we've done four or five different tests on ponderosa pine in the Black Hills, and it just doesn't work. But you can buy it. You know, there's a lot of stuff you can buy that people are selling that just quite honestly doesn't work. So you want to be careful about that. The aggregation pheromone that John was talking about, the other one that draws the beetles in, you know, really it does work too well. And, you know, I had put it this way, the best way I put it is, if as bad as things are right now in the Black Hills, that's the one thing, wide use of that is the one thing that can make things worse.
Oh, okay. Another question I want to get to. This is a joint effort on everyone's part. I have a cabin in the Black Hills, and I have cut and removed my infected trees on my property. My question is, how do I get my neighbors, private and national forest, to take care of their dead trees? Kurt, you're with the National Forest. How do you answer that one?
Well, most in most places in the National Forest, what they've gone to is, if you have land that is abutting against the National Forest and you see dead trees across the line on the forest, you go into the local district and talk to the folks there, and they've been giving people letters to go out and say, go ahead, yeah, you can go out and take down the dead trees. And it's the best thing we can do, you know, right there adjacent to folks' property and to get that immediate beetle population away from them.
Okay.
Is the best thing we got.
Ray, what if it's a private landowner? Can they go to the state? I mean, who do they go to?
The state does not have any laws that would allow us to force a landowner to manage beetles on his property. Our program is specifically set up as a volunteer program, and we'll work with those landowners that want to do something, but we can't force those landowners that don't to do anything. Now, the counties do have some authority to impose rules and regulations on individual landowners, and some of the counties have those enforcement policies.
Okay, last question here. Have any of these susceptible pine trees in South Dakota and other states begun to show any resistance to mountain pine beetles?
No.
No. Is that even a possibility?
No. It's you know, we're dealing with a native insect attacking native trees, and this attack's been going on for literally thousands and thousands of years. So it is what it is. There's not going to be any resistance.
All right. I'm going to give you guys, it's not very much time. If you could wrap it up, you have about 15 seconds to give your last final sentence. As we look at July, and what should people know as we move into that? I'll start with you, Jeff. 15 seconds.
I guess to sum it all up, I want to let everybody know we have a major problem with the mountain pine beetle in the Black Hills, but all is not lost. We still have healthy forests in areas there, and we got to be diligent and keep things moving.
All right, Kurt, same thing.
You know, it is, as Jeff just pointed out, we got a big problem going on out there, but I know that on all levels, from the Forest Service, the state, the counties, and private individuals, and the industry and everything, I mean, everybody's going as fast as they can. I mean, we're all really rowing as hard as we can.
Yeah, John.
But if, as an individual basis, if they've got a couple of big trees in their property they want to make sure survive, May's the month to spray, so they may want to consider that.
What's the one question you get the most?
Well, the biggest question I get is, can I do my own spraying right now?
Oh,
and
well,
again,
we
already answered that. So.
All right. Ray?
I'd say the biggest thing I want to impress upon, especially people outside the Black Hills, is that if you're not familiar with what's happening in the Black Hills, try and educate yourself as to the serious problem that is out there. They can go to www.beatthebeetles.com. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We try and post, that's a state website, where we try and post information on the mountain pine beetle itself, information on our landowner cost share programs, so that'll be available at any time somebody wants to learn more about the beetles. The other agencies also have sites that they can go to.
Right.
For landowners that are concerned about what's going to happen this next summer, we will be developing our priority areas for management, and our new cost share rates will be set sometime later this summer.
Okay, very good. Sorry to cut you off there, Ray.
That's okay.
And I want to thank our guests for being with us tonight. We've got Ray Sowers, our director and state forester with the South Dakota Department of Agriculture. Thanks to Dr. John Ball, professor of forestry at South Dakota State University. And thanks to Kurt Allen with the U.S. Forest Service, Rocky Mountain region. And thanks to Jeff Parrott, representing the Black Hills Forest Resource Association, as well as Wheeler Lumber, located in Whitewood, South Dakota. And thanks to Dwayne Short with Biodiversity Conservation Alliance for sharing his perspective. For more information on any of the programs we've talked tonight, or to get the contact information on our guests and their organizations, it's all on our website at sdpb.org. Now, be sure to join us next week as we take a closer look at Teach for America. We'll find out how this unique program is inspiring teachers and students on South Dakota's Native American reservations. That's Teach for America next Thursday, April 26th at 8 p.m. Central, 7 Mountain. Now, for all of us with South Dakota Public Broadcasting, I'm Stephanie Ristler. Thanks for being with us. Good night. All right.
This program is made possible with your annual membership in the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Black Hills State University, a comprehensive public university offering degrees in business, education, science, and the liberal arts. BHSU.edu.